One of the standout cars from Pikes Peak International Hill Climb is the Enviate Hypercar, built by Cody from Lovefab. Now, while we watched the car at the event, we decided to track it down and headed to Lovefab while the team were working on the car between practice rounds to get a more detailed idea of what makes this car tick. Now, the Enviate Hypercar you could think of as a beta prototype, and the team are intending to produce this car in limited numbers to customers if there proves to be demand. Now, the car was designed purposely to compete in the Unlimited class at Pikes Peak International Hill Climb, and the Unlimited class, as its name implies, is just that. There really are no rules, and this gives the team understandably a huge amount of range to work within. One of the areas that we've seen a lot of focus on in recent years is the aerodynamic performance of the car, and again, with no real rules to work from, the team could really do whatever they wanted here. So this was one of the first places that the team focused on. I actually contracted Sebastian from Sauber F1 to develop the entire aerodynamic package and bodywork for the car. This was all developed and then validated in CFD before any of the parts were actually made. Now, the CFD at this stage suggests that the bodywork should develop somewhere in the region of about 650 kilograms of downforce at 150 kilometers an hour, and at a theoretical speed of 300 kilometers an hour, this extends to in excess of 2,000 kilograms. So you can see the importance there, or the value of that downforce. Now, there are some challenges with designing an aerodynamic package like this, and one of those big challenges is not so much in achieving the downforce. Again, with no rules, that's actually a relatively simple part, but the biggest challenge is getting that downforce and maintaining an aerodynamic balance. What I mean by that is a balance of downforce from the front of the and the rear of the car. If that balance doesn't remain stable, it can have a negative impact on the handling and performance of the car. One of the challenges with cars running high levels of aerodynamic downforce is that it actually has some negative impacts on the suspension design. And what I mean by this is, if we took a conventional suspension design and then we added a huge amount of aerodynamic downforce, at high speed the car can actually end up running on the bump stops. Now, one of the options to counter this is to run exceptionally high spring rates, but of course that has its own negative side effects. The team have chosen to use what's known as a third spring or a heave spring arrangement, which involves a third shock absorber and spring at both the front and the rear of the car. Now, this shock absorber does nothing when the individual wheels are absorbing bumps or running over bumps, or alternatively when the car is rolling in a corner. However, when the car starts to compress under hard acceleration, hard braking, or of course that aerodynamic downforce, that's when the third spring comes into action. This allows relatively normal spring rates to be run on the main shock absorbers, and of course this allows a good level of grip as the car goes through corners and over bumpy undulations in the track. Now, moving on to the rest of the car, we'll focus first of all on the engine package. Now, this is actually a relatively low-cost engine. It's an LS-based V8. It's a 5.3-litre V8 that's relatively common in a lot of GM trucks. It's going to be picked up in the wrecking yards in the US for as little as $400 or $500. So it's a really, really cheap place to start. Now, of course, with twin turbos added into the mix, that stock engine was never going to hold up for very long. So in order to make sure that it was going to be reliable, the team have stripped that bare engine. They've fitted a K1 crankshaft and K1 connecting rods and a set of 9-to-1 JE pistons. Now, the 9-to-1 compression is obviously more suitable to the boost pressure that is now being run. Of course, there's also a modified camshaft grind fitted to the engine, and ARP head studs are fitted to help clamp the cylinder heads to the block a little bit better. Moving on to the turbo package, the engine is fitted with a pair of Garrett GTX3576 turbochargers with 0.82 exhaust housings. At the moment, the team don't have any solid power numbers, as the dyno the engine was initially set up on would only hold up to about 7 psi and about 5,500 rpm, where the engine was producing 550 wheel horsepower. At Pikes Peak in practice so far, the team have been chasing a few issues issues, which included a boost leak, which was limiting boost to only 16 psi. Ideally, the team want to be running somewhere in the region of about 20 psi, where they're anticipating the engine will be making in excess of 1,000 horsepower. With the high level of downforce that this car can produce, this obviously improves the car's ability to corner, and in particular the amount of lateral g-force that the car can develop in the corner is immense in comparison to a run-of-the-mill road car. This creates another problem with the engine's lubrication system, and if the engine was fitted with a conventional wet sump lubrication system, the oil can literally be forced away from the oil pickup and result in oil starvation and damage to the engine bearings and crankshaft. To combat this, the team have gone down the common path of fitting a dry sump lubrication system. This includes an external oil pump that's driven from the crankshaft, which scavenges the waste oil out of the engine back to a remote oil reservoir. From here, the oil is then pumped back into the engine, and this ensures that even under exceptionally high lateral g-forces, or for that matter acceleration and braking, the engine is always going to have a constant supply of oil pressure. With the engine being mid-mounted, this does pose a few limitations on what gearboxes can be used, and Cody has gone down the common path for mid-engined vehicles of using the Porsche G50 transmission. Now, at the moment, this is still a conventional synchromesh gearbox, which means that the driver needs to use the clutch on both the upshifts and downshifts, and particularly in the unlimited class at Pikes Peak, this would be one of the few cars that isn't running a sequential dog box, and in fact, most of the cars competing are using paddle shift, which makes it much easier for the driver and allows the driver to concentrate solely on driving the car and particularly on the downshifts, achieving maximum braking force. Now, when it comes to the braking package fitted to this vehicle, this is also relatively unique, and it's fitted with a set of RPS carbon-carbon brake rotors and a set of StopTech calipers front and rear. Carbon-carbon offers some really big improvements or advantages over a conventional steel rotor, particularly the weight of the rotor is much lower, and this reduces the unsprung weight, but another aspect of this is it also reduces the rotational weight. So you could think of this just the same as if you fitted a lighter flywheel to your engine. It's something that needs to be rotated when the car is both accelerating and braking, and by reducing the moment of inertia on the brake rotors, this can allow the car to both accelerate and brake quicker. The other aspect of the carbon-carbon brake package is that it does work at very high temperatures, but conventionally this actually has its own set of drawbacks, because most of the carbon-carbon brake packages on the market will work at exceptionally high temperatures, making them ideal perhaps for circuit applications, but they typically don't work very well at low temperatures and may only start working properly once they get in excess of perhaps 300 or 400 degrees centigrade. The RPS carbon-carbon package is designed specifically for this purpose of hill climb racing, where there isn't an opportunity to get a lot of heat into the brakes. And the carbon compound used in the rotors and the brake pads allows really, really good brake performance from as low as about 200 degrees centigrade through to around about 700 degrees centigrade. So it's a very wide range, and it's going to make sure that the brakes are effective right from the start line right to the very finish of the hill climb. Moving on to the electronics package, the engine is managed via a Haltech Elite 2500 ECU, and there's a few additional sensors that have been fitted to the ECU specifically due to the Pikes Peak hill climb setup. In particular, the turbochargers are fitted with turbo speed sensors, and this allows the team to see exactly how hard the turbochargers are being worked and where exactly they are operating in their compressor map. At the same time, exhaust manifold back pressure sensors or EMAP sensors are fitted, and again, this is just another input so that the team can make sure that they're getting the most performance out of the turbochargers and the engine in the very thin atmospheric conditions that we see at the summit of Pikes Peak at about 14,000 feet. In the cabin, there is a Haltech dash logger, and this is really a display for the driver as well, so that the driver knows exactly what's going on. There are warning alarms on the dash that will alert the driver to any problems. If, for example, the oil pressure is too low or the engine coolant temperature gets too high. More importantly, when everything's going well, the dash also functions as a shift light to let the driver know when it's time to change gear, making sure that he is using all of the available rev range and optimizing the performance of the engine. The car's already proven to be a fierce competitor, setting second fastest time today here in the practice in the middle section of Pikes Peak, and we really look forward to seeing how it goes in competition on Sunday.